This is my favorite of the tragedies. This is by far my favorite, and I just love the King Lear character. And you know the bad decision he made, but that then he realized the family betrayal, his two of his daughters betraying him. On that scene where he goes out into the wilderness, and he's in the middle of a pouring thunderstorm, and the rain is beating down on him, and he's like ripping his garments off and just saying, "Come get me, God, here I am." Like, this thunderstorm is not as bad as how I feel inside. So just I'm paraphrasing, but just to
Yeah.
take he wanted to be taken out of his misery. So it was just a wonderful portrayal of grief, intense grief and sadness that I
Cathartic.
enjoyed. That was
Definitely
one of the
cathartic.
things. There's the themes, the family betrayal, not just his daughters, but Edmund and Edgar betraying each other. So there were evil characters, but there were also very good characters. The youngest daughter, Cordelia, was it?
Yeah.
And her kindness to Lear. And then I keep getting them confused, Edmund and Edgar, but Edmund, even though his father rejected him, he was kind to his father Gloucester when Gloucester was blinded.
That's
And
Edgar.
yeah, so at that scene where Gloucester commits suicide and he wanted to jump off the cliff, and his son pretended that he had jumped. He was very kind to his father, even though his father betrayed him. So that was very poignant. And also the portrayal of madness, partly a portrayal of madness with the disguised son of Gloucester. He was Tom of Bedlam, I think, Beldam. And you don't know if that's real madness or feigned madness. And that whole scene where they're in the hut and they're putting Regan on trial, they're doing a pretend trial. I was just fascinated by that whole portrayal of madness and an interaction of these characters.
I agree. Kit.
Hi. I don't usually talk. I usually just listen because you guys seem to know a lot more than I do.
No, we're
It's
all
been an
we're
awesome
lovers, not
experience. I've been
experts.
doing this for about a year and I so enjoy it. And my camera's broken and it will be broken until I buy a new laptop. So that's why I'm just Kit.
No
But
problem.
I really, this was a harder read for me. You know, I haven't read as much Shakespeare and it was a harder read, but I just wanted to say that like what I like most about it was how Lear developed this sense of empathy for other people and for people that don't have as much. And like when he was out, I think it was in the storm where he, you know, kind of realized how he should have been grateful for all that he had. And that just really touched me. And so that's what I liked about it. And what I didn't like about it is everybody died at the end. I really,
Yeah.
really wanted Lear and
That
Cordelia to not die. So that's all I wanted to say.
Yeah, you're not alone in that wish. You're not alone. Yeah, I think that's what makes it a tragedy. Camilla, I see you've got your hand raised. We just started with just going around and
Please,
saying
that's yeah.
why this is one of your
That's
favorites.
the whole idea.
Yeah.
Well, it
Over.
is probably, I said Jeff when he asked about the plays. If I had to name a name right away, it would be King Lear. And let me say, first of all, though, just an answer to the previous comment, Shakespeare is the only author of this story who actually kills off everybody. This is not the normal pattern. Often Cordelia would end up marrying Edgar. There was an earlier play that was not a tragedy. So Shakespeare really took the story, which came from very early British history, and put it in the tragic mode, because for him, that's what it was really about. I think this play is about aging, and I think it's one of the most extraordinary pieces of literature that dramatizes the effect of what King Lear calls growing old before he's wise. That is, he has white hair before he really has his black ones. He hasn't learned anything. And the whole play is about him learning what it means to be mortal, not immortal. You know, they told me I was everything. Tis a lie. I am not ague proof. When Gloucester wants to kiss his hand in Act Four, he says, "Let me wipe it first. It smells of mortality." It's the whole play is just couched. Poor Tom, poor unaccommodated man, is no more than this. The idea of losing everything. Maybe the most important word in the play is nothing. Nothing will come of nothing. Speak again. And Lear kind of diminishes down to nothing. In terms of power, authority, money. And then he grows again in terms of love, respect, responsibility, the understanding of where he is and who he is. And that's just until he finally dies with Cordelia. And all he wants to do at the end is just sit in the cage and sing songs with his daughter, his daughter that he has wronged. I think it is, the language is extraordinary. There's just speech after speech after speech. It's dense. It's dense. And this will be the thing I quit with. It's a hard play to teach to young college students. I often say it's very difficult to explain to 18-year-olds what it means to say, how sharper than a serpent's tooth it is to have a thankless child, because you're teaching the thankless children. That's really a hard one to grasp. I mean, it really is a play that gives you a vision of the process of aging and coming to terms with reckoning and reckoning with yourself. It happens that Lear is a king, so you know, he's losing his kingship, but the play has a more universal kind of sense of what the process of aging can be like for people who have ever but slenderly known themselves, which is how Lear is described, and by one of his vicious daughters. And he learns to come to terms with that, and so does Gloucester. They have to come to terms with their children, with themselves, with who they are, and what they have valued in life. So I think it's an amazing play. That's what I have to say.
We heard from Mila and Kit and Dennis why it's one of their favorites. I don't know if anyone in the room wanted to share why it's one of their favorites.
I just have a comment. It's
Yeah.
about it that I think Cordelia was fortunate that her father cut her off, because then she got a husband that really liked her instead of one that just wanted her money.
And he was a king. Like, that's an upgrade. In my opinion, I would rather take the
Mm-hmm.
king than the other two guys who don't really like me that much.
Ben's got his hand up. Dennis.
I loved what Mila said, and I agree. It is about aging and or issues of older adults. That maybe that's why I'm one of the reasons I'm interested in it. And one of the things older adults have to face is your will and transferring property, whatever you have. And I can relate how, in my own personal family, that led to a conflict, and I think the wrong decision was made, and it didn't work out well for the person that made the decision. So I just really relate to this on a personal level, and I think that's what's so great about Shakespeare. You can see everyday life. You could see people in everyday life situations like your own that you can identify with. And feel the either the agony or the joy of what's happening.
Here.
I have a nameplate.
Did you park in the parking lot here? Because I can get you a free ticket, free parking if you want.
I didn't. I will next time,
okay.
though.
Future reference.
Okay.
Here we go.
Oh, it's all right. I got something in here.
Our leader, our fearless leader, Jeff, if you want to. I was
moderate.
Kind of.
You what?
Moderate you.
I just caught my breath after rushing here from Bridgeport, running up the stairs from parking garage.
30, do you need another 30 seconds? Because I don't know if anyone's announced this at all, but if they have, then I'm sorry I arrived late. If they haven't, Kenneth Branagh is going to be at the Shed in New York City from October 15th to end of October to mid-December, 50 performances only. Tickets go on sale April 19th, and he's going to be starring as King Lear.
You're kidding.
No, I'm not kidding.
Edwin doesn't kid about Shakespeare.
I am going to be there ready to bid. I've got a kidney ready to sell on eBay.
So bad, I'm going to be in college in another state.
Is Grandma now?
Is he Lear age?
Branagh? I have no idea, but if he's young, hang on, I'll soon let you know.
Hey, James Earl Jones played him when he was 42 in New York. So. And he did a pretty good job.
Yeah. The last time I saw this was in 2019, and it was at BAM, and the Royal Shakespeare Company did a production. Sir Anthony Sher was Lear, and he was absolutely fantastic.
Was that the one where the fool was his age, if not older than him?
I can't remember.
I heard about a production like that. I like that idea a lot, actually.
But yeah, it was a phenomenal production, and I even bought the DVD of it because it was so good. I don't normally like DVDs of plays, but I had to get that one. So it's one to look out for if you're interested in a really phenomenal production.
Didn't Christopher Plummer play Lear?
Yes, a while back, yeah. And we saw Christopher Lloyd play Lear as well.
Almost.
No comment.
He had some trouble with the lines.
No
Is this
comment.
One of the most lines for an actor?
No,
that's Hamlet.
Hamlet, Richard?
Hamlet's crazy. Henry.
Richard.
Henry's got the most.
Yeah.
Henry.
Henry's up there. And
that's so specific. Which Henry?
Othello.
So
Iago
many of them.
Is up there too. Yep. And then Othello is in, I think, top five is Hamlet, Henry, fourth.
Fourth or fifth?
It's.
I know fifth has like scenes where it's just that man yapping.
They're not that long, though.
Branagh is currently 63. He'll be 64 on the 10th of December during his run as
Lear. There we go.
So book your tickets for 10th of December so you can wish him happy birthday.
That's right.
I wish I could.
Maybe they'll sing that night.
All right.
And he revives for curtain call.
Yeah.
So, I agree with a lot of what Mila said in terms of what I think is wonderful about this play, and it's in the writing, especially. It is dense, but that just adds to the pleasure of going back to it again and again whenever you're called to do so, whether personally or professionally. It opens up anew every time you tackle it, depending on where you are in your life. And when you're young, you look at the Edgars and Edmonds and the children of the folks. And then as you go through, you look at some of the younger parents. And then when your parents reach Lear's age, you see things throughout. And it's so beautifully written and so insightful that it never fails to give me something to carry with me, to carry forward, and hope I remember when the time comes to learn from it. Also, one of the things that I love about this play, it has one of the most powerful moments of any play I've ever encountered. And that's Lear's entrance carrying the dead Cordelia and wailing in sorrow and regret and brokenheartedness. It's just incredibly powerful to put that on stage, a parent carrying a dead child and knowing how responsible he is for it. It's just amazing and amazing. You don't see that moment in too many other plays. I can't even think of one offhand right now where there is one like that. But that to me is just a kick in the gut every time I even read it. It's
Henry 6-3.
Thank you, Kay. I said, well, I couldn't think of one.
Yeah, I know. So are you?
I'm teasing you.
I'm fine.
So anyway, those are the things that I love about it. The rereading of it, the seeing into its depths and layers as you age with the different characters that are in it. And then that moment, that striking, striking moment is incredible. Mila, and then Deborah.
You're on mute. Mila.
We're lip reading you, Mila.
I'm unmuted now. I just had a little trouble finding the button. I just wanted to go back to that conversation about seeing play King Lear, because this is a very, very difficult play to perform. I mean, you have to decide where you're going to start, because he has to rage in Act Three. And so he has to start somewhere lower than that rage, and yet he's totally irrational and crazy in Act One. So it's a very, very, very difficult role to play. Olivier didn't play it until he already had cancer, and then he really felt like he could identify with it. But two of them, I saw Anthony Scheer, and I saw then there are a couple of wonderful films, but two of the most memorable performances I saw in New York, one was Lee J. Cobb. Television actor. A popular actor, but I thought he was extraordinary as Lear. He really had the kind of dignity, and I thought he was amazing. But the other person that I really loved was Glenda Jackson.
That's right.
You know, she's tiny, she's a very small woman, and she is a woman. And usually those kinds of things bug me, and I have trouble getting inside the role, but she was incredible. I mean, she really took that role on, and it was just extraordinary. So I'm going to try to see Braunach this fall, but I do think there are a lot of good Lears out there.
Okay, Deborah Vacher, please.
Hi, I just wanted to speak to Mila's comment, the one before, about teaching Lear to college students. When I was in university in Binghamton, New York in the late 70s, I signed up for a Shakespeare class, and our professor was he was excellent. I mean, he was very tough on us too. And we did Lear. And I have my paper that I wrote for him. And, you know, I read it now and I'm like, oh my God, what was I thinking? He said that, you know, it wasn't so bad, my paper, but I could have gone far deeper. But at the age of 17, 18, I couldn't go deeper. There was just no way. And now I read Lear and it just, like, I feel the physical blow of it. Every line, I'm like, oh my God, oh, that hurts. Because my mother now is she's elderly and in a condition where her kids may need to take some control. And I just hear the play like ringing in my brain, like we need to do something for my mom. But then I hear Goneril and Reagan making all these arguments about how it's, you know, for Lear's, it's in his best interest to take all of his knights away. What need you one? And I was talking to my sister about that today. I said, you know, we're reading Lear. And she said, well, I don't really care much for Shakespeare. I said, well, maybe you should. Maybe it'll help us, you know, figure out what to do right now. Or at least
what not to do.
Maybe some, you know, rationalize what we're doing.
Anyway, my paper, it's, you can't be, and I have another friend who said, you know, he doesn't know why they teach plays like this in high school even, because it's just, you know, kids are kids. And this is a very adult play.
What was the title of your paper, Deborah?
The Dramatic Functions of the Gloucester Edmund Edgar Subplot in King Lear.
Sounds cool, actually.
You know, the blinding, the not seeing, Gloucester's mm-hmm. lack of vision, very physical, but Lear was more of the mental blindness that he couldn't see. What his kids were up to, or what he didn't really know himself.
Yeah.
But anyway, got to be minus.
Yeah, Shakespeare's wonderful at these parallel plots and relationships to examine from variety of angles, these very, very human relationships of parent, child, brothers, lovers, those kinds of things. There's often a reflective parallel for us to measure each of those relationships off of, even to the point where he would change history around in order to make that point. You know, as we speak of the Henry plays, you know, the character of Hotspur with his father is often that parallel comparison between Hal and King Henry, but historically Hotspur and King Henry were the same generation. So Shakespeare shifted it in order to make that examination possible,
which is
pretty cool.
Sometimes.
Especially with English history.
Yeah.
Sandy.
Well, when I put my hand up, no one else had yet spoken about the sibling relationships. And I think that's important in this play. Shakespeare's kind of big into siblings in a lot of his plays. And the things that are going on with Edmund and Edgar, and the things that are going on with Cordelia and her sisters, and that whole sibling thing. And Dennis had mentioned that one of the things he really liked about this play was that you can see people in their everyday life, and you can see, feel their joy or their agony. And I really felt a lot of that with siblings. And I think it's because I'm older too, that, you know, been through a lot of things with siblings. Mm-hmm. And you can feel this. You can be sad and be mad, and you know, that happens with siblings. It's very real.
Yeah, very much. And even as this story goes on, those alliances shifting. You know, you have Goneril and Regan working together at the beginning, and then competing to the point of death, killing the other by that time, and then Edgar and Edmund competing at the start, and then Edmund by the end making that better choice to save,
yeah.
try to anyway, save Cordelia for it. So anybody in the room, and then we'll go back. Yeah, Mike, and then Elle, and then we'll jump back to the screen. Go ahead, Mike.
I'm curious to ask the group what people make of the pattern of eyes and sight and vision, which is the most repeated image in the play. And also if anyone's read Stanley Cavell's essay on Lear, The Avoidance of Love, which I think he said one thing. I don't even remember that. I read it a long time, thought it was amazing, but don't even remember it that well. But there's one thing in there that I remember best, which he talks about shame. And how the reflex that shame gives us is the reflex to avoid eyes.
Mm.
And that if you imagine these relationships with, you know, Lear, Goneril, and Regan, or even Edgar and Gloucester, Edgar and Edmund, and how it's gone over the years, you can imagine that they felt a kind of awkwardness and shame, and that they avoided one another's eyes. And even Lear's partial recognition of Kent in disguise,
mm-hmm.
you know, maybe had to do with some kind of exchange between their eyes that felt familiar to him, even though he was pretending to be someone else. So I'm curious about that question, the question of vision and sight, and how people see it in the play.
Can I ask you, Mike, is that something that you struck on before you read that essay, or did that essay open up that thought process as you examined this? You know, because we make sure that we give you the chance to say, this is what I really like about this play, because that is the thrust of the season. So is that something that you kind of had either a strong sense of or an intuitive kind of sense of this presence of blindness and sight? And then you read the essay, it made a big aha for you, or was it the other way around, that you read the essay and was able to see more deeply into the presence of eyes and looking at each other in this, in shame?
Can you say what the name of that book was again?
The essay is called The Avoidance of Love, and it's by a guy named Stanley Cavell.
Thanks.
But I think the idea that the relationship between parent and child being on some level about what you're allowed to see or acknowledge, and that Lear's insanity comes from having no choice but to see what's been avoided all this time. And so his only way not to have to see it is to go insane. Although he probably is already demented, if you want to talk about it from a clinical, but that's the other side of it. And then also, you know, that did anyone ever see the way Edmund felt in Gloucester's family? You know, did anyone ever care enough to see what it was like to be Edmund? You know? And so those questions were already there for me. And then somehow Stanley Cavell put it together with the pattern of vision and sight images, you know.
Great. I just say one thing about vision and sight. The one thing about this play that stood out for me, I saw it when I was a lot younger, like at school. And when Cornwall plucks out Gloucester's eyes, it's just something so horrific and so vile. Yeah. It just stayed with me forever. And whatever else you forget about the play, that's the one thing you remember. Yeah. It's like the ultimate. To me, it was just like it really crossed a line. Like if they'd have killed him, it almost seems that would have been better in many respects. But to just pluck his eyes out and then call them vile jellies, you know, it's just like, whoa. But it's just so memorable. Mm. And I think that's deliberate. But then how he comes back from that as well, and his son comes to him and everything, I think then it's like the, you know, moving forward from it. But it's still a very traumatic thing to have happen.
But then he dies at the moment of acknowledgement. And that is an interesting. Why does he die the moment he finds out that Edgar is the one who's been taking care of him this whole time? You know, that's a question to ask.
Yeah,
it's one of my favorite moments in this play when they pluck out his eyes. And I will say, reading Oedipus and King Lear in AP Lit in 1 year at the same, like, that's a pairing. Yeah, both of them in my AP Lit class.
We're safety goggles everywhere you go now.
No, it's quite a leap from one of them to the other.
Yeah. I mean, I remember when they did it, like, and I was thinking, is that, as a younger person, like, is that even possible to pull someone? I mean, I know it is now, but yeah. Like, you know, when I saw it, it's just horrific.
I mean, use enough force.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. That's...
Why is Lear pagan? Shouldn't he be Christian during this period, or
no? I think it's ancient Britain, so that would have been pre-Christian.
I think
that's the setting, so it would have been pre-Christian.
And why do they always talk about astrology and name the Greek gods? What's that about?
Well, Mila might be able to speak a little bit more to that. One of the things I remember coming across in my studies is for a while there, it was against the laws or the rules of public performance to invoke the name of God on the theatrical stage.
That's
right. So in order to overcome that, they used the ancient gods in those structures, even though a lot of the philosophies are still, you can still see the echoes of Christianity in it by using the names of the ancient Roman gods. They were able to avoid that. They were able to still give some sense to a higher power structure, but avoid that rule.
Plus, you'd have had a Roman occupation of England long before Christ. Yeah. So the Roman gods would have been known, presumably.
Well, and it's also the study of Latin, too, was in their grammar school. So it wouldn't have been the Greeks. They would have been studying Latin.
Yeah.
And the stories of that's why Homer and not Homer, Horace and all those folks are a big part of Shakespeare's references in his plays are the Romans.
What about the astrology? Like Edmund talks about the eclipse.
Well, that was also a big part of Elizabeth's reign. She had an astrologer that she would use. So it was a part of the society at that time, especially in the court world. There was, I forget his name. Anybody remember? Kay? The doctor? Doctor?
Elizabeth's doctor?
The mystic.
Not by name, no. I don't know the history as well as the plays. Sorry.
Yeah. So it was present. Present there.
I think we're really stupid.
But you are right, very right about the thing about taking the name of God in vain. Yeah. If you look at the early plays, you will see that occasionally they have actual references to saviors and to God without circumlocution. Right. And then it chops off because it was indeed punishable by law.
Yeah, and then it changed. And then I don't know whether it was changed in printing or whether it was part of post-production, whether it was allowed alive or when that changed, but the later plays commonly use the God. And I think that's one of the reasons you'll see in his plays, Jesu, J-E-S-U, and it stops just short of using that name.
Yeah. John D. or
something. No,
John D. D-E-E, John D. It was Elizabeth's...
Jesu was the way it was said at the time.
Say that again, Kay?
Jesu was the standard pronunciation. That Latinate S that we tack on.
Yeah.
They weren't doing it.
Okay, cool. All right, Elle, did you have something else you wanted to share? Then we'll jump back up on the board. Ellen and Fred.
All right, everyone's talking about such depressing stuff. Let's talk about the fool. My favorite character in this play, and one of my favorite characters in the entire canon. If someone doesn't let me play that role before I die, I won't be dying. I will be playing him before I die. I've studied foolery a lot, actually. It's a real topic of interest to me because it's my greatest ambition in life to play every fool in Shakespeare's canon. So from my research, there have been two types of fools, each distinguished by the man in Shakespeare's troupe who played them, whether it was William Kemp, who played more of the what's called a natural fool, which is a literal bumbling idiot, like Bottom is one of your natural fools, Peter from Romeo and Juliet, those are your natural fools, people who are just kind of stupid and they are kind of kept around because they're funny. And then you have on the other side of the coin, Robert Armin comes in after Kemp leaves. Some like internal politics stuff, probably, actually. There's some tea. But Robert Armin comes in, and then you start getting fools like Touchstone and fools like Lear's Fool, which are called wise fools, people who are very, very smart and are hired to act stupid. But the way that they act stupid, it's so good because it's the double meanings in so many of the things these fools say. And then also the straight up single meanings and the things they can get away with because they're the fool. They're the funny guy. They're supposed to be able to say whatever they want. There's a concept called jester's privilege, which you could say almost anything you wanted. And they would kind of just be like, oh, he's just making a joke. He's just being funny. And I don't know exactly how legitimate that is, but there are a lot of things that the fool says to Lear in this play, calls him Nuncle to his face, insults and belittles him to his face. First of all, really, really funny. And second of all, like, if you did that today to someone who was in a position of power, that would not be good. But it was literally his job.
It depends who it is.
Yeah, that's fair enough. It was literally his job. And he gives Lear advice that if other characters tried to give it to him, I don't think he would listen. Right. Because one of my favorite scenes from this play is, I think it's 1-4. Where we see the fool for the first time, And he is just going on and going at Lear about, oh my God, you're so stupid for doing this, because now you split your crown in two and gave it to your daughters, and now you have nothing. So stupid. That was really dumb of you. And Lear doesn't do anything. Lear makes one joking threat, take heed, Sarah, the whip. And then the fool replies, truth's a dog, must to kennel. I don't remember the rest of that line. But he doesn't take any action against the fool. It's actually Goneril who tries to, because she's annoyed with him. But the point of the fool is he's such a unique niche within the play of that kind of advisor who's not afraid to tell it like it is and to insult the heck out of him, because he does. And I love him so dearly for that purpose. And the fact that the fool sticks with Lear pretty much until the end when he drops off the face of the earth, which something, something, Lear and Cordelia and the fool doubling, something, something. Not sure how valid that is, but we'll never know. But yeah, he kind of just falls off the face of the earth. And it kind of makes you wonder, where did he go? Because that's when things start to really go downhill and everyone starts dying. And you're like, oh, maybe if the guy who was actually keeping this man in check and actually making sure that this man didn't kill multiple people, he didn't, you know what I mean? Making sure that multiple people didn't die. Maybe if he was here, things would have turned out a little bit better and it would have been a funnier play overall. Like maybe we could think about that. TLDR, I adore the fool with all of my heart, and I don't think that the play would be as memorable as it is without him in it because of that niche that he has. And also he has some really good insults. I love them so dearly.
That's the thing I just wanted to quickly say, following on from what you said about the fool. I wondered what happened to the fool in this play, because I've seen the production with Ian McKellen and Sylvester McCoy as the fool. And in it, the implication is he's hung.
Because he says fool is hanged.
And then in other productions I've seen, he just kind of either I blink and miss the sentence, but he's just no longer there.
Yeah,
I'm like, what happened to him? The other thing is you said about the two types of fool. There's people who are foolish, and then there's those that are like employed as the fool, as you say, more like a sounding board for
and
the king.
And you'll notice that within their texts, they're more often referred to as clowns.
Yeah.
Clownery is an art.
Yeah.
A fool is an idiot.
Yeah.
So that's that difference. Like, Festi is referred to as clown.
Yeah.
What he does is an art form. What Lear's fool does is an art form. But then you have characters like the fool in Titus Andronicus, who that's literally just like a stupid guy.
But then there's the other fool in the fools in this, which I found out, I did not know this. Lear refers to his fools at the beginning, meaning his children.
Mm-hmm.
And I had no, when I studied this play, I found out, I learned that fools could also mean their children.
Yeah.
Which is why that line at the end could be referred to Cordelia.
Exactly.
Honest. Something, something doubling.
So a couple of things when you asked about the fool's privilege, it's mentioned in As You Like It. When Jaques wants to be a fool, he asks the Duke to give him that protective position and make sure nobody comes back at him for poking them in the way the fools must. You should read the book Fool by Christopher Moore.
I'll write that down because I'm going to forget that.
It is a very, very funny book that tells this entire story from the perspective of the fool in the play.
Ooh, I like that a lot.
And it's hysterically funny.
I like that a lot.
It's great.
Writing that down so I don't forget it.
When we come to Hamlet, was Yorick a fool we never met?
And then the fools of Shakespeare are from a long tradition of fools. And one of the positions is to be able to somehow through is to speak certain truths to power, because that's your job, is to pick things out if you are known as a witty fool.
And if you can make them laugh, they're much less likely to want to cut your head off if you can make them laugh.
And you need that privilege, again, to point, to throw your darts at members of the court and have the highest in the room protect you.
Because he's able to make Lear kind of face the decisions that he's made. I mean, like, oh, this guy is making fun of me. Why is he making fun of me? I think my decisions are perfectly rational for X, Y, and Z. And he has to sit there and listen to himself say and think those words and say and think about those reasons that he has for justifying his actions. And then he can look at those reasons for justifying his actions and go, oh, these actions were not justified at all. what have I done? Mm-hmm. And then we have that last chunk of the play where he's like, oh my God, what have I done?
Yep.
But that's my tirade for this week.
Great. Ellen.
Hey. So, oh, to be a fool, Motley is the only wear.
Yeah, indeed.
It's probably the only line I know from Masmore. a couple of things. One thing is I wanted to jump in and tell Deborah that I'm from Elmira, New York. So you said Binghamton, and I went, woo! and also on the topic of hard to teach to college students. And when I got to college, I took a Shakespeare class, and I had only ever read, I'd seen Romeo and Juliet, the beautiful young people, and I'd read Macbeth in high school, and that was it. And then we read, 8 or 10 plays in the course of a semester, and I thought I remembered all of the plays that we had done and had filed them away in my memory to the extent that I could. But when I retired 3 years ago, one of my stated things that I wanted to pursue at least part of the time was to fill in the gaps of the Shakespeare that I had read and seen. And of course, because I'm a retired actuary, it had to have a spreadsheet. I have a spreadsheet of, here's the plays I've read, here's the plays I've seen, here's the plays I've neither read nor seen. I need to do one of those things with all of these plays. But I was sure I'd seen Lear and that I had not read it. And Fred and I went to read Lear's about a month ago, and we have an audio book, Archangel audio book, and one a day we listen to an act, and then we stop it whenever and go, now wait a minute, who's that, and I had to do myself a little mnemonic of, okay, with Goneril and Regan, that's alphabetical in age order, and then they married Albany Cornwell, and that's also alphabetical, so okay. Got it. And Cornwell's the really bad guy because he plucks Gloucester's eyes out. But the fact that I didn't even remember that I'd read it, but I've got all these highlighted passages in my Pelican Shakespeare from college. And so, it doesn't resonate very well with college students. I think you're right about that.
Is there a line that you highlighted in college that when you look, you can see a different truth in it, but see what it was that made you highlight it then?
Well, I don't know. I was probably highlighting with the idea of quoting it in a paper or something. And I had the very first thing I highlighted was nothing will come of nothing. Yeah. And then I highlighted on the next, just a couple of speeches later, Lear says, let it be so, thy truth then be thy dower. Blah, blah, blah. So I was just sort of gobsmacked that, oh my gosh. And I read it and I highlighted it and I just don't remember.
Just didn't stick, did it?
It did not. And unlike a lot of people in this group, I haven't yet immersed myself in the world of Shakespeare as much as I would have liked. But I'm, really enjoying the, 3 or 4 plays a year that Fred and I are reading together, and most of them are with this group.
That's great.
Great. Excellent.
There's always time.
Fred, you want to? Sandy, is your hand up anew, or is it up still?
I'm sorry, it's up still, but you know why? Because it's at the top, and for some reason my top is cut off, so I didn't see it.
Okay, I get you. All right.
Lower.
Sure. So nice to be here. Ellen's in West Hartford. I'm in Boca Raton, Florida. But also my copy of the Pelican Shakespeare from that same Shakespeare class with the same.
Yay, Pelican.
Yeah, it's actually, it is. We haven't told the story, but it is where Ellen and I met many, many, many years ago.
What school?
At this little tiny school in North Carolina called Duke University. I just have a few comments, kind of back at Kit about all the death. The first time I read Lear, I was in having a year abroad. I was at the Manchester Grammar School in Manchester, England, and the students were asking about the plays that we were going to read, and someone said, "Will we be reading Lear?" And the professor said something that has been a joke of mine for all these years. He said, "Ah," he said, "bodies everywhere." So despite all the death, there's always that one pithy line that lets people know that you understand what happens in Lear. I'm very happy to hear this notion of jester's privilege. I've never heard of that, but I've taken it many times, so I appreciate it. Now I have a name for it, Ellen. The thing that strikes me, and when the next time I read the play, I'm going to do it with a highlighter, about all the imagery of darkness and blindness, and I just noticed it this time through. It literally drips out of every page, and I would just like to kind of enumerate that. But it's this notion that, and someone was mentioning, you know, kind of light and dark. This notion of not only physical blindness, and like really they pluck the guy's eyes out, that has to stick in your memory, but metaphorical right. blindness as well, right? And this is really Lear's curse, where he starts out blind to his own family, his own daughters, who loves him and who doesn't love him, what love really is. And at the end, you know, it doesn't last long, but he does finally see. And to me, that is the theme that really runs through this play. And I never saw it more than this read through in so many passages talking about, you know, eyes and light and vision and blindness. It's a theme that just runs throughout. The last thing I will say is, getting slightly older myself, someone said at the beginning, someone said, "How old is Branna?" And I heard, "How old is Grandma?" So, I guess I'm getting old too. Anyway,
thanks. Well, maybe Grandma wants to play Lear.
I don't know.
Well, if you think Lear finally sees at the end, then what do you make of the fact that he delusionally believes his daughter is alive?
Like, you know, that's the beauty, that he, you know, all of his gears start slipping. Yet there is this realization of his own, you know, that he's the, you know, maker of all this pain. Is there a kind of a sense of responsibility or a knowing? I can't pull the exact lines out. But, you know, great, great point. You know, he's both nuts and has his highest level of clarity at the very end. Pretty cool device.
There is also a possibility where falsely proclaimed deaths are not uncommon throughout history. Mm-hmm. So as a parent, you hope. And you seek for any opportunity to, again, deny what's potentially reality in the hope that maybe we're wrong, because proclaimed deaths, that where the person's not really dead, has happened for centuries. So the point where Edgar Allan Poe wrote stories about that, and it was so common that during that time they would sell people a casket bell in case you were wrongly proclaimed dead and buried. There was a bell above your gravesite with a string that went down into your casket.
Oh, Lord.
In case you woke up.
The dead ringer. The dead ringer.
And
that's where it comes
ring
from.
The bell. Yeah. And hope somebody was nearby who could dig you back up.
Kay disagrees, or
not dead.
Kay, you're on mute.
That was applause for a magnificent line, sir.
I know I just came back, but
Mila, then Kay.
Okay, I want to say, there are two or three things I want to say very quickly. Number one, Jeff, that law about not jesting with the name of God was passed in 1605. That's the year that King Lear was written.
Ah.
So it's exactly coincidental, but it's also true that this is a pre-Christian play. I mean, it's about England before England was Christian. And so there's a sense that the Christian God is not a relevant God to this historical period. And while Shakespeare wasn't very accurate historically, he had some sense of those things. So that's the first thing I would just throw out there. The second thing is about The Fool and Cordelia. There are many people who think the same actor played both of them. They're never on the stage at the same time. And so once it's Cordelia's coming back into the play, the fool has to go away because there's no one else to do the role. I don't know if that was true or not, but certainly it would give a little added punch to that, my fool, the hanging line about the fool at the end of the play. But in any case, that's one. Certainly the fool disappears without cause, and every producer has to figure out how to handle that. So it is an obvious kind of glitch. He's also sort of served his purpose. I mean, it's like he's already said everything he needed to say to King Lear, and King Lear is ready to start learning the lesson. So now he needs to learn it from experience, and he doesn't actually need this privileged fool there telling him all that stuff at the same time. So that's a second quick thing. The in terms of seeing and sight, I think you're right. This is absolutely crucial to Shakespeare in two plays, frequently, but especially in two. And they're the two that are written one right after the other, and that's Othello and King Lear. You know, Othello is looking for ocular proof, and he doesn't see anything. He only hears a story, and then he believes it because he's looking with the wrong eyes. One of the ideas that the Renaissance inherited from the Middle Ages is that there are two sets of eyes. One of them is physical, and you look with them, and the other are the eyes of the soul. They're the inner eyes that actually help you see the truth. And, you know, Kent says in Act One, Scene One, I think, "See better, Lear, and let me still remain the true blank of thine eye." So see better, Lear, is really kind of the main directive of the opening of this play. It's Gloucester who goes physically blind, but certainly Lear has been blinded all along. But there is this notion that there's a kind of intuitive way of looking. They would think of it as the eyes of the soul that are interior. And the physical eyes can give you false truths that you don't actually see well with those eyes. And then the last quick little thing is about the siblings. I really always like the way Shakespeare takes up for outsiders. I love "You Gods Stand Up for Bastards." I mean, I think Edmund's speech is one of the most interesting speeches in the play when he's announcing who he is and complaining about it. But it is also true that this play is asking a very serious question about how daughters like Goneril and Regan can be born. Is there some cause in nature for these hard hearts? That's what that little anatomizing scene and the trial scene in Act Three is all about. But at the end of the play, it is Edmund the Bastard who says, "Some good I mean to do, despite of mine own nature." And he tries to save Cordelia too late. He's already ordered her killing. But Edmund has a moment of slight redemption. And he's the one who would have a natural proclivity to dishonesty or to bastardy, who would sort of be thought naturally to live up to that condition. And he does not quite do that. And the girls, Goneril and Regan, there's no redeeming them, period.
Yeah, great. Thanks, Philip. So when we're talking about the gods in this and the pre-Christian Christianity, one of the papers on this play that I did in graduate school was I tracked every time the word nature and natural was spoken in the play and looked at where that was. And there's a real structure of the world to the natural order of things and how that plays out in a certain strata of nature. And you can see it being referred to over and over and over again. And the planet's position, to go back to what you were asking, Lisa, the planets is one of the higher powers of the natural order. And when they get out of whack, when anything gets out of whack of the natural order, the whole system feels the reverberations of it. And there's a lot of, it was a long paper. There were a lot of references to nature and how nature gets disrupted in this, both in terms of the forces of nature, Edmund's proclamation toward nature, thou nature art my goddess. And then Lear talking about the unnaturalness of his children going against their father. All these things come into play in it. And that's kind of the power that's being examined in this world rather than a Christian structure of power, isn't it? It's a pretty cool exploration of it. We'll go Kay and then to Mike. Go ahead, Kay.
I've accumulated so many things I wanted to say.
Let's go back to why this is your favorite play. What do you love about your favorite play?
It is my favorite plays. This is the richest, densest, fullest, chock full script of them all. There is more to be milked out of this play than any of the others, and that's saying a huge amount.
Yeah.
So much sauce.
And I don't know if it's my favorite even, but I mean, since so many of them, I suppose it adds up. I did want to say a bit about the fools. First of all, clown meant lower class person, peasant, clodhopper. That's what it meant. And so when they say somebody is a clown, what they mean is he's not one of the gentry we've got running around. Costard in Love's Labour's Lost is called a clown. And it's because he's an earthy fellow who doesn't play all these aristocratic games and stuff and so on like that. But yeah, the difference in Lear. I've got one Lear on the brain because they did it last summer at the Colorado Shakespeare Festival. Ellen McLaughlin played Lear, and it wasn't a woman playing Lear. It was Lear getting played, and it didn't much matter. There was nothing maternal about it, but it was so parental, and it just, you know, bah, anyway. And in that one, the force of the storm, you know, we live in Colorado. We know what deadly weather is like. Thank you very much. It's not wind and rain, right?
Right.
Except in that one, the fool dies of the exposure. There's no lines after that, and after that scene. And he dies. You know, they get up to try to leave the hut and they have to carry him off because he's gone. I'm right behind you. Play all of the fools, please, 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 and then write your memoirs. Please.
I'll try my best.
Yeah. Awesome. Thanks, Kay. Mike and then Dennis.
And we have a quote from Fred, too.
Okay. Good.
You know, one other interesting element from that Stanley Cavell essay I mentioned. He says that he believes that when Lear first wakes up after being taken in by Cordelia from the storm, when he says, I think I should know you and that I should know this man. His theory was that Lear believes he's seeing the King of France rather than the doctor. That was Cavell's theory about it. And then when I looked at it through the play, you had the King of France, you had a messenger who tells Kent that that the French army is coming.
Yeah.
And Kent asks the messenger, is France coming with his army? And he says, no, he left it in charge of a general because he needs to deal with some stuff. Then you have that doctor. And what I believe is that all three of those characters would have been played by the same actor, France, the messenger, and the doctor, who are all these people who come and go for brief periods. So in other words, what I'm saying is I think the doubling of actors could have contributed to this thing that Cavell was picking up on, that maybe Lear wakes up and thinks he's looking at France.
Yeah.
So all goes to say that I think that the doubling of Cordelia and the fool is also very significant. And the way I see it is that they both touch or light up a certain place inside of Lear. Like something truer to his own heart is awoken by both Cordelia and the Fool. And so I think there's a kind of brutality to the Fool's disappearance and replacement with Cordelia, because what it does is it makes it all within Lear's gaze and Lear's perspective. In other words, on some level to him, it's the same person.
Right.
It's the same actor.
Right.
And the whole problem of the play is Lear's inability to step out of his own perspective. And I think that that doubling is a way that that's imposed on the audience. So the audience becomes complicit in that. And the reason I think you don't need a fool on the heath, or you don't need a fool with when Lear is with Gloucester, is because Lear has become his own fool. And in his madness, when he's babbling about, oh, adulterers, let them go, everyone wants it, he's now embodying that perspective, but he can only do it as a madman. And so that to me is the question of it, is Lear's ability to step out of his own perspective.
Cool. Dennis, then Jason.
Oh, I'll let Jason go. I don't know if he's spoken yet.
Okay, yeah, Jason. Thanks, Dennis. Jason?
Dennis.
Yes, I thought this play was amazing. It just, there's so many lines that just keep building now, the drama. And then actually there's lines that suggest what was going wrong. And they're just so subtle. We probably, you know, skim across them. Like near the end, Edgar has this line, we should say what we feel, not what we ought to say, something to that effect. And that seemed to be one of the problems. People weren't talking about how they felt about anything. And they were talking about what they ought to do in terms of the splitting into the kingdom and the relations to one another and in the civil war that's, you know, starting to brew in, I guess, old England. And nobody was really paying attention to, you know, how they were being destructive with one another. And it was just, you know, they seem to be abstract in their relationships to one another. I think that line really captures that. So, but it's such a subtle line at the end, though. It's like, yeah, you know, it's very, you know, it's not really given much attention in many discussions. So it would, yeah, be nice to hear what people have to say about it. Thank you.
Yeah, that's cool. And that's one of the things I love about Shakespeare, too, is in such succinct phrases and lines, he could really capture something so incredibly deep and true about us as human beings. But to go back to what you were saying, Jason, about speaking authentically, and that's one of the troubles, that's kind of what starts the whole thing, is when Cordelia speaks authentically versus her sisters who don't. And she speaks what she feels, and she speaks the truth of being an about to be married woman and an adult woman. And that gets her and all of England in trouble from Lear's reaction to that, speaking of the truth. There was a quote that Fred put in, to go back to Mila's inner eye is that from a play, Fred?
No, or, The Little Prince.
Le Petit Prince?
The Little Prince.
Oh, okay.
And it is only, it says, it is only with the heart that one sees clearly, what is essential is invisible to the eye. I paraphrase that's, slightly, but
that's, yeah, what I forgot.
There
to this
go.
Day, I look away when they are blinding Gloucester. I don't dare watch.
Oh, interesting. All right, Dennis.
Yeah, one topic that interests me in general in a lot of plays is the sympathetic villains. So Shakespeare has a lot of really good villains. Many of them have good reasons. They have reasons to be angry at the world or society. They have very valid grudges. And someone at the beginning mentioned Edmund, and Mila did too, that he was, as the bastard, he was second class. And at the very beginning, he's kind of made fun of, and right in front of him when Gloucester was talking to somebody. And you could say the same for Shylock. in Merchant of Venice, he had really good, he was discriminated against. He had really good reasons to be angry. Richard III was hunchbacked. He had physical deformities. Oliver, who was Orlando's brother, no, that doesn't fit. But anyway, it's how these characters respond. You can respond by doing something positive, or you can respond by doing something evil. And people like Edmund and Shylock and Richard III respond by promulgating the evil that was put on them. They're like just carrying it forward. So that's not honorable. It is good that Edmund did kind of redeem himself at the end. He was somewhat apologetic or regretful at the end. But that's just a theme I like seeing in different plays.
Cool. Edwin?
Yeah, no, I just wanted to say, I think Herb put it in the chat. That's the Kindle edition. Anthony Scher had a diary called The Year of the Mad King, and it was a year run-up to his preparation to play King Lear. It's an excellent book, and I highly recommend it. The link there is on Amazon. You can buy a hard copy. You can buy a Kindle if it's of interest to you. But I really recommend it if you're a fan of Lear. One other quick question. Jeff, when do you think you'll play Lear in Capital Classics?
I can't remember lines now. Iago killed me for memorizing lines. After that, nope. Give me a clown any day.
Yeah.
I was going to say something. What were you talking about before I asked my other question? Oh.
A Year of the Mad King.
Yes. And anybody who is a fan of or has not yet experienced it, a three-season television series out of Canada called Slings and Arrows is just fantastic. And the third, and it was written to be a three-season arc. And that third, what they do is there's a play that the festival, a Shakespeare play that they're doing, and then the real life of what's going on in that world is paralleling the play itself. Well, the last season of that series is Lear, and it's beautifully done. So I strongly recommend Slings and Arrows if you've not encountered it. It's a great, great series.
Borrow them at your local library.
Yeah, quite likely. Yeah, Elle?
I wanted to speak to the end on what Dennis said about how Edmund and a lot of the other characters that you were talking about, the villains who have really good reasons to be doing villainous things, how they take their sense of justice. And I wrote a whole like essay response on this a couple months ago in my lit class after having not read Lear for 3 months and doing it completely from memory. But the way I see it, Edmund and Cordelia are perfect foils of each other in that way, because they're both wronged in very similar ways. They're both disinherited. They're both looked at by their dads and gone, nope, you don't get anything when I die. And that's really not fun to have happen to you. That's really not that fun. And they both react in these two completely separate ways, where Edmund, his sense of justice only goes as far as the concept of revenge. Cordelia's sense of justice goes as far as the concept of forgiveness and of waiting for it all to work out in the end. Edmund doesn't trust that, and he takes it into his own hands, and then a lot of people die, even himself. But I think it's so interesting to look at the two of them and what they're doing, where we have Cordelia sitting there in France and being patient and trusting that, yes, Lear will come around eventually. He'll realize what he's done. He'll realize that he was being an idiot, and he'll come back because he's a good person. And then you have Edmund actively causing the deaths of at least three other people. And it's so fascinating to take two different people who are in relatively similar situations and see how they go completely opposite directions. But that's my little spiel.
Cool.
Thanks.
Hi.
Hello.
Do you guys want to offer anything up to the crowd?
I'm a newbie to this, sir.
Welcome.
I have yet to read my girlfriend knows a heck of a lot more about it than
you.
You
joined us before.
She has.
I was here for
a I didn't have a chance to
recognize you. Yeah.
To get into the book yet.
Yeah.
I'm just a old soldiers from the streets and the mountains in New Hampshire.
We're late,
but,
so we just came.
And we were delayed by forward hopefully.
Sure.
I will study before I come back.
All right.
I am a great book reader. I love reading books.
Right.
This is new material to me, yeah. But I will get myself
awesome.
Into it.
Awesome. And well, adapt. Welcome. Glad to have you. Glad
you're,
to have you back.
So pleased that you guys
thank
are here.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you for having us.
Yeah, you betcha. All right, Kit, there's a hand up. Kit's hand is
I,
up.
I We're just gonna, had yeah. one quick awesome. Question.
Yeah.
I know that I would love to see it. I did see the Christopher Lloyd Lear, and it wasn't great. And
yeah.
But I don't have anything to compare it to. That was the only one I've ever seen. Is there a film version that anybody would recommend?
Good question.
You can get the Ian McKellen one. I think that's through the RSC. The Anthony Scher one, if you go on the RSC website, you could probably stream it.
Royal Shakespeare.
Okay. Royal Shakespeare Company.
Yeah.
If you just Google
Perfect.
That, you could probably find. I recommend Anthony Scher, and I've seen the Ian McKellen one. It's like 20, I think McKellen's like 2018, something like that, 2016. It's recent.
Yeah. And
great,
you may be
you.
Able, there is a video out there of James Earl Jones in Shakespeare in the Park in New York. And he's pretty good too.
You could probably find good productions on YouTube for free as
yeah.
well, to be honest.
Yeah.
There's a good one on Digital Theater Plus that I watch.
Can I just throw in another movie very quickly? That's all I had my hand up for. And
yeah.
that is the one directed by Peter Brook, the black and white movie with Paul Scofield. It's a very different kind of Lear. It's very bleak, but Brooke is an extraordinary director, and it's always been my favorite Lear. So it was
great.
Made 50 years ago, but it's good.
Yeah. Thanks, Miller.
Great. Thank you so
much.
All right, Kay.
Kay,
you can finish us up.
I just wanted to, I have not yet seen the face of the voice that did the comparison of Edmund and Cordelia. I thought it was brilliant.
Yeah.
And I actually misheard it at first because I
Hi.
Am. Yay! Go you! Go you! Because
you.
The comparison that I have been hearing for lo these many decades is the two injured innocents, Cordelia and Edgar.
Mm.
The comparison of Cordelia and Edmund is brilliant. Thank you.
Thank you.
Anne just put something on there. Amazon has. Oh, it went away.
Yeah, it's the Marquee channel.
Marquee,
can,
thank you.
Marquee, and you
versions,
can like get
all
the everything from the Royal Shakespeare and Company.
Great.
Thanks,
Anne.
Can someone
right.
put a mirror under Charlie's nose to make sure he's okay?
yeah, maybe. Somebody will stir him awake. So we'll get back together again in a month, Monday, May 6th, where we will address lighter fare, and we will look at why we like A Midsummer Night's Dream.
We do.
So, yes,
yeah.
I do.
So
damn it, I like it.
It's just
early.
I'm
glad we get a month.
Midsummer Night's Dream.
For next month.
All right, well, thank you, everybody, for wonderfully intellectual, insightful, terrific... conversation over a very rich, rich, rich play. Appreciate you all. Have a
Thank
great
you.
April.
Bye, folks.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, Jeff, everyone. Bye.
Off the heath at night.
God bless.
Thank you.
Thank you.